I'm head of learning access here at the gallery. So I'll do the housekeeping with Izzo first. Please make sure your mobile phone is turned off or on silent for the duration of all sessions. Also, please note there is a small error in the program. Morning tea this morning is at 10 a.m. and we will reconvene in here at 10:30. So we don't have an hour long morning tea, unfortunately. Make sure you sign up for tours if you are staying till Thursday afternoon. This needs to be done by tomorrow morning, so please endeavour to do that at morning tea. The lists are on the information tables in the Gambler's Hall. Remember that the Megalo workshop participants are required to wear covered shoes for that workshop. Please be ready to leave for the workshop at 1:30 p.m. and meet at the front desk where Tess and Janita, two of our on-call educators, will be waiting for you. If you are unable to walk to Megalo, which is about 2K, we can drive you in a minibus, which will leave from the front of the gallery at 1:40 p.m. If you're going to the National Portrait Gallery for the showcase session today, Michelle Belford, our school's bookings officer, will be going over there at 12:15 with all of the presentations. Your speakers want to check their PowerPoints. She will leave from the level one foyer on this level, and the NPG is just across the bridge. Some of you may have already found it. And if you are heading over by yourself, please make sure you arrive there by 1:00 p.m. If you're booked in for the photography workshop this afternoon, please meet Fiona, another of our on-call educators, at 2:15 in the level one foyer on this level. Please remember this workshop now starts at 2:30 p.m. The drinks this afternoon are for all delegates. All delegates are welcome to those drinks. So please join us in the sculpture bar in the sculpture garden this afternoon. If you have parked in the underground car park, the gallery's underground car park, please be aware this is a 3-hour car park that is patrolled by patrolling inspectors. Unfortunately, we do not own this car park and have no control over this. So please keep just an eye on your watches in terms of how long your car's been there during the day, up until 5 o'clock. Please note that the Twitter handle on the screen is the one we are using, not the one printed in the program. So it will come up on the screen in a moment. Okay, that's it for housekeeping. Now to our first speaker of the day and our second keynote of the conference. It gives me great pleasure this morning to introduce our second keynote speaker for the conference, Sean Gaidlaw. Gaidlaw is one of Australia's most original contemporary artists, whose spellbinding images that address personal histories of contemporary culture linger long in the memory and have had an extraordinary impact both locally and internationally. His work references both street culture and a highly nuanced take on cultural history. Working across video, performance, painting and sculpture, Gaidlaw's subject matter extends from self-portraits depicting the artist engaged in various extreme sports through to investigations of athletes and their dynamic relationship to the urban environment. Gaidlaw's videos conjure complex ideas and associations. His works are illuminating studies of the human form in motion. Gaidlaw completed an honours degree at Sydney College of the Arts, University of Sydney, and undertook postgraduate research with the College of Fine Arts at the University of New South Wales. He was awarded the Samstag International Visual Arts Scholarship and conducted associate research at Goldsmiths College, University of London, in 2001 and 2002. He is undertaken an Australia Council studio residency at the Cité Internationale des Arts in Paris, as well as other residencies and commissions in Europe, North and South America, and in the Asia-Pacific region. He has exhibited widely in the past 10 years throughout Australia, the United States, Canada, and Europe. Sean has had numerous solo exhibitions and importantly represented Australia at the 52nd and 53rd Venice Biennale in 2007 and 2009. Most recently, his video, Approach to Mundi Mundi, was the powerful introductory work to the exhibition Australia at the Royal Academy London. Gaidlaw's work is represented in the National Gallery of Australia and the Museum of Contemporary Art, as well as several major public and private collections in Australia, New Zealand, the United Kingdom, and the United States. Today, we have the pleasure of hearing Sean discuss his practice in a paper titled, A Gesture for Your Function, The Skateboarder's Guide to the Universe. Please join me in welcoming Sean
Gaidlaw. Thanks, Katie. All right, I'm going to start off talking about my painting practice because I actually started as an art student in the painting department many years ago, And it's just a good way to kind of lead into the ideas that I've been exploring and developing since then. But we're going to start off with oil paintings, if that's all right. Okay. And also, one other thing I wanted to mention at the outset was that I'm interested in showing some videos here today, but I would like you to keep in mind that there are several concerns that I have about this, showing videos in this context. And one is that you're not really seeing the videos as I would show them in a full presentation. So, I mean, I guess a lot of you have seen Fiona Hall's talk here yesterday morning. It's quite obvious that we're looking at photos, reproductions of sculptures. And I would like you to keep in mind that it's actually the same thing with video, that it's very easy to think that you're seeing video in motion and it's the actual video. But in fact, it's not. It's not a video that's been installed in specific conditions with a particular size screen or projector, etc., etc. So just if you want to just keep that in mind, it's always tough showing videos in this context. But anyway, I really love painting. I never really stopped painting. It's just that I started making videos and they seem to gather momentum. But this is what I was doing in the late 90s, these kinds of works. They're actually appropriations, digital manipulations and appropriations of work from the UK or England at the time, I guess, in the late sort of 18th century. And I really sort of focused on appropriating artists such as Thomas Gainsborough and Joshua Reynolds. So it was quite fun being in the Royal Academy recently and seeing some of the original works that I had appropriated as a student. And I guess what I did was effectively decapitate them aesthetically. You know, I sort of would always paint these sort of veils over the heads of the portraits. And the reason why I was doing that was because I was interested in portraiture, you know, as a genre and how it operated and why it was so effective. And for me, I guess I saw the face as being the privileged side of identification. It was the face that people would always go to if they're trying to access the individual identity of that subject. And so it was an exercise for me to then veil the face and then, of course, shift the focus to things like gesture grammar and what the body was saying and every other signifier in the painting, right down to the background painting of the landscape and the kind of clothing, etc. They were very detailed paintings. They took me quite a long time. But at that stage, I was interested in having a studio practice. This is the work installed in a show at the same time, 99. So you can kind of see that there was a kind of seriality going on as well. You know, what I would do is I would get reproductions of these paintings, and I would scan them and then digitally manipulate them. Usually I would compress them so that they would be 50% of the width of the original painting, and then I would sort of veil the face. And this is another shot of them installed in Ika, in Western Australia. And there's a sculpture in the foreground there that involves a computer and a vacuum cleaner. I'm really into vacuum cleaners. I really love vacuum cleaner design. This is actually a DC02 designed by James Dyson, fantastic machine. No bag, no loss of suction. I was really interested in, at this stage, not just using images from the past, which I sort of fetishized in a way. I love them, I think, because I hadn't got access to the original works. You know, they were so far away from me. Being a Western suburban kid in Sydney, I felt like they were actually on another planet, these historical images. And so I started working with references that were, I guess, dearer to my heart and closer to my personal experience. And when I think about where the work comes from, not on a technical level, because that's quite easy to explain, this is oil and canvas, and it was produced as a kind of patience painting exercise in the studio, but where the work comes from in terms of influence, that's a much more interesting question for artists to ask themselves, I think. And for me, I guess the inspiration, it really crashes in from all sides. I mean, I guess Katie summarized what I did just before, but it really does come from this this personal experience that I had as a kid watching films like, you know, George Lucas's Star Wars, which had a, you know, incredible impression. But it also comes from, you know, my family history as well, and that interest in art history and theory. And this is a good example of that. This is an image of Elvis Presley, which I thought was appropriate, seeing that there's a great show over the road of the young Elvis. But I tried to make him look like Walter Benjamin. But of course, everyone with that kind of moustache and glasses ends up looking like Groucho Marx. I was also, I guess, under the spell of a kind of an art movement in the late 90s in my art school. I was a real product of Sydney College of the Arts. And at that stage, you know, we're kind of riding the wave of postmodernism, and the entire institution was very much under the influence of artists like Iman Tillers and the strategy of appropriation. So when you look at paintings like this, I was actually being a good little student and looking at what was happening at the time and trying to master that technique of appropriation in my own way. Certainly I was interested in painting techniques, but also why I would go to a book cover and try and reproduce that as faithfully as possible. And it's great seeing so many Iman Tillers' works here in Canberra, because I have an ongoing relationship with that artist, which will come up through the presentation. But in this work, Subway Art, it really is the kind of Bible of graffiti art. This work, this publication that the painting's based on, really disseminated this scourge of hip-hop inspired graffiti throughout Western centres, and now really it's a global phenomenon. So what I did was I actually put my own kind of graffiti sort of piece right next to the title of the book cover, which I repainted, so I kind of include myself in that history in a sneaky way. I would also do these kinds of works, very experimental works, where I would reproduce paint book covers and then sandwich them in these butterfly prints. So there'd be this kind of chaos that's kind of, you know, undergirded by this more sort of realistic figurative painting. And there are a lot of fun to produce as well, because you would see these paintings sort of destroyed in a way. Like, I was interested in this overlaying, which happens in graffiti art quite a lot, which again it's a part of my history. I sort of come to visual art through these other forms, through street art or graffiti art, and through things like skateboarding, etc. This is another work, a Corbet work that I manipulate and put a kind of strange form, special ship-like form over the horizon. And then I turn to some Australian references. So this is a very famous work by John Glover. But for me, I really did like the idea that it needed to be personalized. Like, I love the fact that people would look at Glover's works and see these kind of curvilinear eucalypts, and that he had this kind of colonial lens. He was kind of getting it right and wrong at the same time, trying to describe the Australian landscape. So for me, the way I would experience the landscape was through, at the time, skateboarding, and they were also curved pieces of wood. So it made sense to draw that juxtaposition. I sort of shoot off everywhere, like in terms of references. This is a text by Michel Foucault on the grid. So it's getting heavy, right? There's a bit of theory involved here. A bit of text-based works, which was good, because I did like the idea that some of the work I was painting was a part of my reading list at art school. I tried not to differentiate between what I was reading and what I was painting at one stage. And I just manipulated Magritte's pipe. And I would also work in sculpture at the same time. This is a bit later. But I'm also obsessed with camouflage, which is weird. I don't know why. I kind of started thinking the reason why I've been asked to speak today is because of that connection to Fiona's work with camouflage. But it was an absurd use of camouflage. Obviously, this sculpture uses the Star Trek ship, the USS Enterprise. If anyone knows their science fiction a very famous form. But it's also a form that I kind of used quite a bit. So I was sort of jumping around and experimenting. This was the photo on your left. It was taken by my mother with my brother and myself. So you have the first version of the USS Enterprise, and then I reshoot that scene when I'm at art school, and then more recently when I've lost my hair. And the interesting thing is that the spaceship grows with us, that the writers of the Star Trek series, you know, evolve the ship, and I've literally grown with that narrative. And then kind of in 2000 I decided to experiment with some video, and that was probably my first mistake, you know, because now I've become completely obsessed with the medium. But what I did was I still wanted to work from this space that I knew, which was the kind of activity of my family, my siblings, my own experience. And so in a sense, this project that I sort of undertook was like a kind of self-reflexive sort of ethnography or something. I was looking at the way that I behaved around my siblings. This is actually a show of my brother. The video is really just me recording what my brothers were doing on trail bikes in the kind of outer western suburbs of Sydney at the time. And it was just a bit of tomfoolery. I asked them to jump over one of my paintings, which was a painting of the 20th century fox symbol. It was the kind of change of the millennium. So, and actually no one hit the painting, which was amazing. It survived. And then I began a series of works that were much more experimental, including this one. And I don't have any sound for this, but you can kind of get what it sounds like. It's just skateboard wheels grinding away on the pavement there. And with this work, I mean, I guess this idea of not actually seeing the video, just seeing a kind of a representation or a version of it. It's usually shown on the floor, so I project this work on the floor, and where I can in this talk, I will flip to images of how the video is installed. And the work came from a whole lot of thinking around different ways of moving through cities. I thought that what I truly know about, like at this stage as an art student, was moving through cities on skateboards, and that became a perfect place to start my work from. And so what I did was I got on my skateboard with these very small cameras at the time that were being marketed as handy cams or camcorders, and I just went out and skated on the same line over and over again on the road. And at one stage it was dry, and then there was another moment where it had just rained, and I would just repeat that kind of that work. And it was like I was interested in that Paul Klee quote, you know, that for him drawing was like taking a line for a walk. And for me, I just wanted to do a version of that, but rolling and tracing lines with my skateboard. Then the videos became more kind of set up as landscapes, because the work that I just showed you was more of a sketch. It's just a drawing. It didn't need to be a complete work. It could have been just an experiment. But this started to kind of look a bit more like a considered work. You know, and I was having to ask other people to record the performances and set them up as full compositions. So this work just looks at a series of skateboarding performances that are in and around water features, mostly in Sydney. And actually the kind of colloquial term for this space was Frank Sartor's skate park at the time. Looking for the park was an amazing place for skateboarding, even though it wasn't really officially condoned. But I was obviously having fun making this work. You know, it was about a kind of enjoyment and freedom to express oneself in these public spaces, maybe despite the details of the law or whatever. There was no great crime taking place though. But it was also thinking about maybe the history of skateboarding being connected to surfing. And so, you know, the skateboard kind of returns to this water that it kind of emerged from. And there's all of these different sequences where water is somehow in the video. And at the time, you know, I started to think about what it was about skateboarding that I was interested in, apart from actually skateboarding. And I think it was this idea that skateboarders operate like artists, that they look at the world in a different way. That we have this relationship to the urban environment, and you're expected to use it in one way, which is the intended function of those kind of civil spaces or that urban architecture or furniture. And then there's this other way, this other potential way of using things like water fountains or park benches or stairs. And it's about the skateboarder projecting their own function onto those spaces. And the Australian art theorist Nikos Papagragialis, he talks about this term. He sort of developed this idea, which was parafunction, that what you have is you have like the design function of something, and then you have someone who comes along and projects their own function onto that, which is a kind of parasitic function. So that was kind of the thinking behind these works. There is a lot of fun just happening in the work of skateboarding, but I was thinking on this other level. I just think there's one other. It was very focused work, a very kind of simple work. It was just about skateboarding around water. And that led me to the next work, where I was still interested in skateboarding near water, but I thought I would change the kind of composition again and work around the sort of seaside. This was actually on South Bondi. And again, it's a very simple work. I was just performing in front of a camera. I asked my friend to come down to the beach, and we waited until the storm was rolling into the beach. And I wanted to have that sort of same strange relationship that skateboarding had to water. I read this great book by Raphael Zarka recently, and he said that skateboarding emerged from a day without waves. So, you know, the history of the world where skaters were usually surfers who couldn't surf that day. So this work didn't want that relationship to the ocean, but of course at the time I was interested in the tradition of romantic landscape painting. And instead of reproducing a sort of an example of romantic landscape painting from whatever phase of that movement, it made more sense for me to personalize it somehow, to try and understand the ideas behind that movement, but through my own terms and my own experience. And that's why I decided to skateboard in the conditions that would have been seen as romantic or dramatic. And because I was always interested in painting, even though I was making video, I was thinking of people like Turner and that incredible moment in painting history where Turner decides to shift his subject matter to weather itself, that trying to depict the nebulosity of weather became the key objective of the painting, which of course helps develop a whole tradition of abstraction. I don't want to have to rehearse that history, you guys know it, but it was a very simple way for me to try and access that tradition or refer to that tradition in a location that I knew very well. And I like the idea that if I made a mistake, I would actually be in the water trying to surf. You can see actually surfers out there in the background. I wasn't alone. There were other things that were happening at the time as well. I did like the idea that that Bondi, even at this stage, I mean, it's such a famous, well-used spot, that there were moments where if the weather was that inclement or the tempest was raging, you could kind of get the beach to yourself. And it was one of those beautiful moments where I just found myself on this little platform and there was no one around except for some other mad surfers out there. But the idea behind the work set up a kind of logic for other works to follow. And that was to really look at the way that things that I was involved in were represented in pop culture. Things like BMX bike riding or skateboarding, even to an extent graffiti art. And there was always this kind of way that these activities were presented on television and now of course on the internet. And that is a very fast and furious, a very energetic way. The way that they're edited is through jump cuts and furious soundtracks. It's what I call the MTV logic. But for me, that doesn't represent the entire experience of these activities. Even with all of the kind of sound and the fury, there is a kind of stillness that you can kind of be in the eye of the storm somehow, psychologically and even physically. And so for me, to use techniques like slow motion and fixed frame, which is, you know, just the camera not moving at all, not only does it kind of make the work more painfully, but it does give people the opportunity to actually see what's going on and be able to sort of analyze or even maybe meditate on the work, rather than just happening in this very fast and furious way. Which is, of course, what I love as well. I mean, I'm not against that MTV logic, it's what I've grown up on, and I love it, but in terms of thinking as an artist or trying to think critically about these activities, I had to use something that would bring a different perspective to these activities. And it was tough because at the time, slow motion was used quite a lot in video art, especially in the 90s and, you know, in the early noughties. But I was probably coming from an interest in things like sports action sort of replay, like slow motion replay in whatever sport it was, cricket, football, whatever. But it still felt like it was the best way to represent certain activities. So this is a work called Tangara, where, again, these are very early works, so the quality of the video is very kind of grainy. And it's amazing that I was using quite good cameras at the time, but now you could shoot a better video on your phone. And in fact, I destroyed the camera for the storm sequence, it just got so wet it never turned on again. And again, the idea behind this performance is very simple. I'm thinking about functioning. And I'm thinking about how does like these features or these details in something like a train carriage operate? How do they function? So you have these bars and these poles to try and stabilize us, you know, when we're rocking around in these carriages in inner city commuter train. They really do rock, as a lot of you will know. And to do a performance like this, I was trying to like invert the function of the bars, the poles, so that actually what they'd be used for is something kind of dangerous rather than something to do with safety. And you know, I read this amazing essay by a guy called Dick Hedditch, who wrote Subculture: The Meaning of Style, and he analyzed, say, the use of a safety pin that was inserted into, say, a punk's nose. For whatever reason, that the punk's using the safety pin as a kind of an inverted sign. The safety pin is designed for safety, obviously, but when it's used in that way, it kind of inverts the symbolic function of that safety pin. So I guess these were the kind of ideas going through my head making these works. And also I was interested in the history of performance art as well at this stage, which was always based on endurance and stamina, especially in the 70s. And here's an example of how I would show that work. You know, this was my commercial gallery in 2003, and I jackknifed the door and showed it behind the door. It wasn't immediately obvious where it was, actually. And so, and I always liked there was a relationship to, say, like, the handle of the door or something. So if I was interested in like say, the creative use of space by performers, whoever it was, myself or friends, it made sense to push that into the way that I would display the video. That it wasn't enough to just look at this idea of a creative, like, appropriation or relationship to space that could work presented in some way that thought about its immediate environment. And this was one of the first works where I used another performer, because the only reason why I was using myself was because I couldn't convince my friends to do that stuff. And I was still thinking about portraiture, I must admit. You know, I was still thinking about different versions of maybe self-portraiture, but then I wanted to portray other aspects, and also specialists, you know, who were incredible at what they were doing. And in this work, I'm going to fast forward this to the performance by Emma Machito, sorry. She dances capoeira, which is this Brazilian sort of martial art / dance form. And I asked if she would do this in a gas station down in Woolloomooloo. So the title of the work is just Woolloomooloo Night. With Tangara and this work, Woolloomooloo Night, I actually did like the idea that they were Aboriginal terms, and this is of course an Indigenous place name. The great thing was that the location at a certain point in the evening was overrun by seagulls. You know, that the cars would stop and the seagulls would move into this place. And so that the start of that video, you just see these seagulls flying through this service station. And then Emma Magenta then just starts to kind of begin her practice of capoeira. And one of the things that I was interested in exploring with her was not actually a kind of choreographed performance of this amazing art form, but if she would rather just practice, as if she was just training, and that would involve maybe doing the same moves again and again. And I also asked her to just ignore the camera, which is a very hard thing to do, because obviously they're there recording video. And so what happened was the kind of, I call it the Edward Hopper effect. You know, she's in this unnaturally lit environment, and we were in the dark, quite a long way away with a long lens, and so she didn't actually know where we were. And this was kind of setting up a style of video making. I'm not even going to call it directing, because it's not even directing. It's more like being a voyeur with a video camera, overlooking from a distance. You know? And that way the performances could just kind of happen in their own time. Even at this moment in the video, nothing's happening. We're still on a roll here. And so I love this idea of psychological and physical downtime as well. That everything I was seeing associated with these kinds of activities were always highly edited, and just about those very poignant kind of high key moments of the athlete kicking or the athlete winning or whatever. But actually that's not the way that it always happens, that there's this other side to those activities. And more often than not, there's a lot of training involved, which is where I wanted to come in. I wanted to show this focus just, you know, down the road. And probably the closest I came to surfing on my skateboard. And also, it's again, this idea of using these spaces. So in the last photo, it's like this kind of use of a service station as a performance space for capoeira. And this is obviously having fun in Canberra. And then at other points, the location didn't really matter. It was more a focus on the human form. And so obviously I really loved this environment where this performance is happening, which it just happened to be Cook and Phillip Park again, Frank Sartor's skate park, which is also a great head skiing location. And at the time, there was an amazing breakdancer in Australia, Danny Pomeres, who just happened to be the world champion head spinner at the time. I just think that's amazing that someone can be a world champion in history. But I can assure you he was amazing, and I think the video is a testament to that. And with Danny, there's the similar kind of techniques that are coming up again and again. Slow motion, the image is inverted, and there's no movement within the camera. So that the idea of recording the video is a very simple process, and the special effects aren't really that special at all. People can very easily work out what the tricks are, which I liked. That at first maybe it's a little bit perplexing, but it's very easy to see that it's an inversion. And again, at the time, it's a kind of connection between different interests that I had. It was an interest in, obviously, breakdancing and hip-hop culture, but it was also an interest in this idea of artists trying to kind of look at something so kind of impossibly large as an idea. One key reference was Leonardo da Vinci's Vitruvian Man. That the Vitruvian Man was, of course, Leonardo's kind of attempt to illustrate balance and symmetry in the human form. And then you have people like Le Corbusier's Modular Man much later. And this was my pataphysical man. And I love the idea of pataphysics, which of course comes from Alfred Jarry. And it's a kind of an absurd science. And so the title was also kind of complex in this work because it was an appropriation of an Iman Tiller's painting from the mid-80s called Pataphysical Man. And so here I was still thinking about Iman Tiller's and his strategy of appropriation, just in the title of this work. But if anyone knows about Iman Tiller's painting, it's a great one. And this is another version of, like, it's the same idea, but a much more elaborate work that I did in 2009, so I'm sort of jumping ahead quite a lot. This is Centered Pataphysical Sweep, where it's a lot of different athletes who are kind of spinning in different ways. And so just the act of spinning became interesting. You know, I think of the whole practice of, say, dervish spinners, and there's different references there. Around 2005, 2006, 2007, I did a lot of traveling, and I was interested in this idea that the stuff that I was working on was a kind of language that had sort of developed throughout the world. That things like BMX, bicycle riding, or skateboarding, through global kind of media transmission, globalization, whatever. There were athletes everywhere doing this sort of stuff, and that we found that we were sort of speaking a common movement language. That I could go to somewhere like Busan in South Korea and work with these athletes, and that we had maybe a language barrier, but actually we were working on the same project in terms of our sport, and that was great. I think that's one of the great functions of sport, just in general. You have this kind of these commonalities, even though the local communities had their own inflection of the sport. And these kind of sports maybe didn't have the same institutional support as other more developed sports or whatever. And so this was in for a work that I did in Brazil, looking at different performers over there in different locations as well, but all of these kind of similarities between how they would use their bodies, how they push their bodies. The performer on the left is kind of a transgender dancer, and the performer on the right is a skateboarder who doesn't have the use of their legs, but certainly does not stop them skateboarding. They're amazing. So there were kind of different uses of the human form, and a kind of tenacity as well, like individuals who push through certain limitations and reinvent themselves. Yeah, this was a work that I produced in Japan. It's called Inner Station of the Metro, so it does make this reference to this Ezra Pound haiku. And at the time, I started thinking of my video works as being haikus. There's something weird going on in the video on the top frame there. That doesn't usually happen, but anyway, the video is a very simple performance. Basically, what happens is I'm going to shuffle through it so that you see another sequence, because this one is double. Two performers, two breakdancers, they assume this pose, which is called the baby freeze in breakdancing. It's the moment of the dance that it's like the full stop of the dance routine. And it's a very difficult pose to hold for a long amount of time. Usually it only happens for a matter of a few seconds, but these breakdancers from Tokyo were really amazing at the time, and I asked them if they would want to just do the baby freeze, no other part of the breakdancing routine, just the end part, and if they could hold that for as long as they possibly could. So it became a kind of torturous performance. I'm sure they hated me after this video, but they were very good at holding this pose for that unbelievable length of time, which is then stretched again in slow motion. And so my thinking behind the work was that, at the time, breakdancing was also very popular and well-known, just in general culture, pop culture or whatever. But I did like the idea that this started to look like a different dance form, like the dance form of Buto, which was developed in Japan and in completely different circumstances that, I'm sure a lot of you know that form, where the body is kind of exhausted and then the dance starts happening once the body wants to stop. And there's some incredible examples of that. And so it was kind of like trying to relate one form to the other. And also the idea that the bodies were very still in this space that was so incredibly congested. It was Shinjuku train station in Tokyo, which is one of the, apparently it's the busiest metro station in the world. So literally like a plug for human bodies, millions of people moving through the space. And then I did a series of performances. This is in Poland, which then looked back at my love for painting. And I did these works where I sort of used spray cans and also like a lot of food products as stencils to produce these kind of astronomical images. And the thing with these works was that they were produced very quickly, that they're kind of almost like fast food paintings. They would be painted on these boards that would start off white, and then they would move into these images of planets and whatever, and then in this frame you can see that I will erase the image as quickly as I produce the image, so that you see the whole cycle of a painting. But it would happen in a matter of, I'm trying to get faster at this, but a minute and a half. This is a video that I just did recently in the UK. And you can kind of see that there's these objects that have been placed and scraped along the board and whatever. But it's there's no time to show all this work in full. And that's how I would display the work, on a monitor that's just leaned up against the ground of the gallery. So I'm usually kneeling in the space. And then around sort of 2008, I decided to come back to Australia and start making work about a subject matter I felt like I knew very well, like that I had some close relationship to, but I had never really explored physically, which was the Australian outback. And it was a strange sensation, because as a coastal dweller, I felt like I knew the outback just through so many references in Australian cinema and art history, but my experience of the outback was very limited. I'd only taken a few family holidays out there, and so what I did was I packed up my bags and I took a few friends out into the desert, and I lived out there off and on for quite a long time between 2008 and 2010, I guess. And I started to kind of do these tests, where I would sort of start calibrating cameras and looking at color, and I would do a kind of line work that that work that I did on my skateboard, I would sort of rethink. And I'm constantly doing that. I'm constantly like coming up with an idea and then revisiting it in a different way or with different, more channels of video or different vehicles or whatever. This is obviously a much faster line work on a desert highway. And that's how it was exhibited. And this is just a quick shot of the sketchbooks, just to give you an idea of how messy I am, but also the kind of thinking behind the work. So you have like an image of, say, Sidney Nolan's Desert Series, and there's a Jean-Michel Basquiat painting, Writing with Death from 88, like his last work. On the top is, at the very top of this is the top left sketchbook, is a study by Leonardo, his allegorical study. There's a work by Joseph Beuys, poster from Mad Max, etc., etc. The top right sketchbook has Henry Ford looking in the Alpha Omega symbol through down to Gibson in Mad Max. And I built the kind of replica of the car out of Mad Max. So I guess going out into the desert, the key references that I have of kind of knowing the space before being there was obviously through cinema and films like Razorback and Wake and Fright and Mad Max. And so it became useful to kind of use the props of some of these films as a way into the space. Here the intercept is kind of literally disappearing into its own smoke. And that's how I would show that work on a PlayStation portable, inserted into the wall. And this is a work from that same series of experiments I did later, which is it's a still from the video that I just recently showed in London called Approach to Mundi Mundi. And again, I'm obsessed with indigenous place names like Imam's Killers. And wherever I'm working, if there is an indigenous place name, I love to recognize that fact. And this is such an incredible space. It's like an inland sea. I'm going to really shuttle through this work because I'm sort of running out of time. I really want to come in on 45 minutes here. This is a similar idea to Approach to Mundi Mundi, but it was done on this interceptor, this Mad Max car. And it's a very simple work, similar to the line work in so many other projects before. I would just revisit the space. I just look at the same location again and again. And so, obviously, the left channel is in full daylight, and the right channel's the onset of this storm, which took a long time to wait for, because it doesn't rain out there often. It does at the moment, thank goodness. There's a whole kind of historical precedence behind working like that. Like, I was interested in, say, Monet's ruined cathedral facades, where he would just continue to look at the same church again and again in different conditions, or Cézanne has the same process, and again and again throughout history you have almost like a kind of scientific observation space where the painter would take one work, Monet, whatever, Van Gogh, Haystacks, whatever it is, and analyze it from so many different perspectives, or not even a different perspective, but the same perspective in different conditions. And then I did a work that was kind of an ongoing work where I would look at this ritual where I was obviously pretty disturbed by the amount of roadkill kangaroo out in the Australian desert. So it made sense to make a work about that. And so I would sort of stage these performances where a motorcycle rider would go to the shoulder of the highway and address these roadkill kangaroos, which are usually just left to rot or deteriorate or whatever. And so the work was kind of, it was a ritual in a sense. It would happen again and again in different locations. I would never ever set the kangaroo up. It would produce the work where it was happening, where the whatever the macropod was dead, and it was a very simple process. It was like Charon, the kind of ferryman to the underworld, who would take these recently deceased souls across the River Styx, in Hades. It was like the road became the River Styx in a way. So it was kind of also looking at examples in in very famous examples in Western art history, or a kind of trope in a way, like say the Pieta in Christian iconography or whatever. This is my last work. I'm running out of time. I'm actually right on time. So I moved from the Australian desert to a different desert. This is Afghanistan. And in 2009, I was asked to work over there with the Australian War Memorial. And it was a very interesting experience. You know, it was a tough gig. But what I did was I was very interested in this idea of working with soldiers at doing what they were good at, which was using technology. Because being a soldier these days is obviously dealing with so much different kind of technology, including surveillance technology and all of the kind of more dubious forms of technology that go into surveillance and whatever, drone. This was actually quite close to a drone site. But the soldiers were very good at being open to experimenting. And this is an experiment where two soldiers are looking at each other and recording their movements simultaneously. And it was just a game that we were playing where one soldier would move and the other one would have to copy their movements. And pretty soon the game became a little bit more complicated, where one soldier would then start to try and deceive the other one in which way they were moving. They sort of goose-step the other soldier. So the very simple exercise started to become a pretty complex game of deception and movement. But it was, again, looking at video and the way that video was functioning in this environment, and how incredible the soldiers were at working with the camera. And also for me to remove myself and let this process happen without me controlling it too much. Maybe just suggesting the parameters and then letting it kind of grow. But it's also about sort of, you know, issues of freedom as well. How can you express yourself in a space that is so tightly controlled, like a military base in Afghanistan? And that's a kind of a theme that's kind of been throughout the work for many years. Is I'm not like an artist like, say, Ai Weiwei in China, or a group like Pussy Riot in Russia. I'm not working under an oppressive sort of political regime. But what happens when we arrive at this idea of freedom? How do we exercise it? And how far can you push it? And isn't freedom a kind of series of negotiations anyway? You know, and it's probably a good point to end on, because it's, I think I'm going to hear the gong pretty soon. It's 45 minutes. So that's it. That's the work. There's many more slides, but I'm just not going to. I just made too much work.
I'm Joe, and from Bismore Water Secondary College. I heard a story. We've got the MOVE collection at school. We use it as a resource. We use it quite frequently. But I heard a story when I was at the launch that when you were filming storm sequence, you actually became a bit sick from exposure. Would you care to share that story with us?
Maybe. I think I was feeling sick because I ruined the camera, you know, actually. I don't know if I felt that sick. I think you get adrenaline when you perform, but that's a kind of a good sickness. I think I'm addicted to that kind of feeling of that acidic stomach thing. So I'm not sure. Maybe I mentioned that I was adrenalized or something, and the camera was borrowed from my university, so I felt pretty sick. I had to go back and tell them that I needed to replace their camera. Maybe that was somehow misconstrued, I'm not sure. But But I'm cool with that story that I was sick after. How they're battling the elements.
Oh, hi, Sean. I'm Yuda from Scotch College. My boys love seeing your work. Something you haven't mentioned, but something they always pick up on, is this overriding sense of danger that seems to be lurking behind everything. I mean, the last one was almost the perfect example of the soldiers in the most dangerous setting playing a game. Is that something that is really part of your sort of thinking?
Yeah, I think that danger is a very attractive subject, for sure. And I guess I've grown up with all of these different kinds of activities that are, of course, flirting with what you can get away with, how you can try and play gravity, etc. So yeah, of course, danger is a huge subject, and also I like the idea that that certain athletes can be very graceful in the face of danger, that they can somehow override that biological fear mechanism and even overcome fight or flight and dance in dangerous contexts. So yeah, of course it's and also I like the idea that maybe like you were saying, maybe that people connect to the work. It's always a struggle for me to try and do this. I'm not sure if the work is that successful, but if people get into the work and they've never really been into contemporary art, that's a thrill for me. If people come along, they've been dragged into a contemporary art museum by their parents or whatever, and then they look at a video that involves something that they do on the weekend or that they love, and that's their way into it. So, you're right, I should mention danger.
Can I just add something else? Because quite a few of the guys, they want to go out and make their own high danger, do you, obviously there's safety precautions, would you have roads closed sometimes and things like that when you go out and make these videos
I should say yes.
I like the fact you didn't, it's sort of losing my history, but
I mean, I guess when I started, it was very humble, I'm just taking a video camera and getting out there on the road and things like that. Line work video, I mean, what I would do is I'd set up a very strict rule where I would just follow the line and just make a split second decision to just continue the line wherever they crossed each other. And pretty soon you would end up in oncoming traffic doing that. So, it was kind of a dangerous exercise, but I would always exercise a certain amount of common sense. I didn't want to kill myself doing any of this stuff. And I think also that you get quite good at doing this stuff, and that's why I started using experts in other fields. I'm not very good at capoeira, and my breakdancing is much to be desired. So I would use experts in those fields, and they're very capable. A lot of the videos is a negotiation between myself and these athletes and working out what they would like to do. I wouldn't push someone to do something that they didn't feel capable of doing. So, I don't know if that answers your question. Now it's, I guess certain productions maybe have like a budget for safety, and I can, close things off. And recently I shot a film, like a short film, and that was totally above the board. So I feel good. Good question, thank you.
Could you talk a little bit more about your relationship to the landscape while you're in the Middle East?
Yeah, I think that was very strong because obviously I love deserts, and I had a very strong relationship to deserts before even making the Australian desert work. I spent a lot of time in North Africa and Rajasthan and India, and I just love deserts. I think they're amazing spaces. So the opportunity to go to Afghanistan really caught me out by surprise, really, because I was there obviously for the geopolitical conflict, and I wanted to address that. But what I didn't really calculate was how beautiful the landscape was and breathtaking it was. It's just such a majestic arid space on one hand, and then so incredibly fertile and full of life in these green belts or these valleys. So even that work that I showed, it was a kind of 360-degree kind of, you know, panopticon of the landscape. It was an excuse to look at the landscape as well as develop this idea of a performance. So yeah, the landscape was very powerful as an idea over there.
Mira here from the National Gallery. I know we've seen some of the videos, as you said, in a kind of imperfect viewing environment, but I know too, you, and following on from what you've just been saying about collaborating with other experts, that there is sound with some of your videos, and you work with people like Kazumichi Grime on the storm sequence and that sort of thing. And I'd like to know a bit more about how you work through that collaboration with those people in terms of how much direction you give them, or how you choose people because you know the sound that they make, or how, when it might suit your work. So tell us a bit about that process in your art making.
Oh yeah, that's another good question. They're all good questions, right? I'm gonna think about this one. It's I guess some works that I showed did have sound, and some of this diegetic sound, you know, just the local sound, like say in the line work series. And then other works, like say Tangara, have no sound. So I love that idea that it's kind of space-like, that for the price of a plane ticket, you get a space travel sort of ship experience. And I love that silence. But in Storm Sequence, it was it seemed appropriate to have a soundtrack. And that was probably the first work where I asked a composer like Kazumichi Grime, who I worked with quite a lot, to develop the soundtrack for that piece. And it was great because he's an experimental electronic audio artist. And I talked to him about the idea behind the work, that I wanted to go out and skateboard in storm. And I talked about the historical references. And then he came up with this idea that I thought was great, where he decided to record the bioelectrical storm that's going on in his body by sort of shorting audio jacks on his tongue. And so you hear this kind of crackling. It was a very beautiful piece. And I also like the idea that it's quite ambient and spatial, which is again countering that MTV experience that I was getting everywhere else in skateboard, which was the heavy metal or hip hop soundtrack, which of course I love as well. It's not like I've got anything against that. But it just seemed appropriate to develop a piece that was very connected to the work. And that happens quite a few times. So yeah, sorry about the lack of audio there.
Questions? It's like you join me again in thanking Sean for sharing his insights into the trajectory of his career to date. It's been wonderful to hear from you in person. So thank you, Sean. We are running a little late, so today we're not as flexible as we were yesterday because we've got external workshops this afternoon. So if we could please endeavour to be back in here after morning tea at 2:15.
Could Jonathan, Marion, Taffy, and Denise just come down for 5 minutes, please? Thank you.
What's your interest?